Yeah.
I think one of my favorites is that during equals you would reward me with nuts in between takes, which sounds wrong now that I'm saying it out loud. But that would be like,
yeah,
my
that sounds
treat.
A little weird.
I'm completely a rewards based actor. It's like if I do a good take, then I get like a snack that is a treat.
yeah, that's
anyway.
Right. We'd have little cashews and almonds and whatnot. If you did a good job, we would feed you. Sometimes cheese would come into play.
I'm very simple. My contracts are very easy. I'm Nicholas Hoult. I'm here talking today to Drake Doremus about his creative process, about his movies, about things we've made together, about things that he didn't want me in, casting mistakes he's made, not casting me, et cetera, et cetera. So thank you for being here, Drake. Let's start with the fact that a lot of your films, people will know that they're not particularly scripted. So there's a lot of improvisation. Maybe you can start talking about the inspiration, where it comes from, how the concepts come about and how you start to develop them from those first stages.
It started for me, my mother was a founding member of the Groundlings here in Los Angeles, so I grew up in this improv-centric world and then was really fascinated with film and then went to film school and learned the more traditional form of filmmaking and then kind of just started experimenting in 2010 with a hybrid format. To me, it was just so much more interesting to kind of collaborate with the actors, and that's what we've done as well, on building the characters, finding the moments, going through the rehearsal process, and really trying to understand the truth of what's going on. And sometimes the idea of just having something that's so specific and having an actor just execute that kind of takes out the discovery process. I'm always trying to execute the scene with as little dialogue as possible because I think it's more interesting that way. And dialogue can be like a secondary weapon, essentially, as opposed to like the most important thing. I'm not big on that. So it's not as important to me as what people say, but how they say it and what they're feeling and what's going on in the scene and what they want from each other.
As actors, you know that you're doing the climax of a film or the end scene of a film. And there's this kind of, you know, in many ways, it's almost like being an athlete where you kind of,
yeah,
you're mentally preparing for things, or you know, like, it's like you can sometimes tell when someone's doing their audition scene when you're watching something because they've done it so many times. It's the big scene where you get to learn about the character or whatever it is. As actors, you know, we were kind of, you get zoned in, particularly when you're doing something where we're improvising a lot and you really have to be in the emotions kind of in between takes. You're not necessarily breaking that up too much. And so the intensity can build and build and build, and then it can kind of overstretch what the moment is, or you can't just let it live in it as opposed to, and you kind of overcommit as opposed to just letting it do its work for you.
Wow. That's so true. And I think for any aspiring actor out there, I think that's a really good piece of advice. That makes so much sense. I mean, you really do have to give yourself to it. Anytime, we talk about this all the time, acting, effort. It's like I always pride myself on finding and working with non-actory actors. You know what I mean? It's like I'd say Boucher, Anton Felicity, Ewan Guy, everyone that I've worked with, who I've been so lucky to work with, it's like everyone's not, they're not acting. You know what I mean? Effort's taken out of the process, which is the most important thing. Is anytime you try to do something, you've already failed. You have to let it come to you. You have to live it from the inside out. You have to let it be what it wants to be. You have to give yourself to the moment. You have to listen and let it happen and let it be. And that's, I think, the best filmmaking and inspiring filmmaking.
Were there any directors when you were growing up, were there any films or directors that you watched that you went, okay, or that you read about or that you learned about in film school that you're like, oh, that's a process that I want to run with, and that's how I want to try it, or you saw on screen and you wanted to recreate somehow?
Pretty much About a Boy, I would say. I watched that and I was like, that one day, when that kid grows up, that's where I want to be. You know, I really, to be honest with you, it was like watching, Lars von Trier's movies, Breaking the Waves, Dancer in the Dark, even Cuarón's Y Tu Mama Tambien, things like that. It just felt so alive to me. There's no confinement. You know, the exploration in the moments just felt so unhinged. Like you had no idea where it was going to go because you really felt like the actors didn't either. I mean, I think one of my favorite things about something you said to me, and I think Felicity said it to me too one time, is like, when you guys finally watched the movies, you say to me, I don't remember saying or doing any of that. And that's always like exciting for me because I feel like that just shows how much in the moment you are and how much you've given to that moment and how lost you are inside of it.
Yeah, I would say that working with you is very unlike the process of working with other directors that I've worked with, in the sense of there's a lot you can do in prep, but there's also nothing you can do in prep. It's not like you're ever learning lines the night before and turning up like, oh, I know this scene, I know what's going to happen. It gave you a lot of areas to explore. It's also nerve-wracking because you sit there and you're like, okay, well, what are the blanks? And you find the blanks gradually. But one thing that you said to me that I found inspired a lot of confidence was that when you get in the edit, you don't care about continuity. It was all about just finding the real moments. That gave me a lot of freedom, I would say, to just be able to do anything anytime and not worry about it, as long as it was honest, which is kind of your main thing.
I love that. Well, that's so... That's why I'm obsessed with, you know, this sort of French New Wave style of editing anyways. And I grew up on Soderbergh movies and how, you know, Traffic for me, the editing of Traffic and Marioni's editing on that movie really influenced me. And it's kind of the same way where it's like, if you do every take with the exact same blocking and it's exact, you're focusing on things that aren't really about the emotionality of the scene or the pivot of the scene. And it's like, I don't want my actors thinking about, oh my God, I have to sip the coffee at this exact moment or else it won't match. To me, it's like, you're getting in your way and you can kind of feel that, the execution style filmmaking. Hit this mark, say this line. Same thing, we don't have marks. Every take, the blocking changes. I mean, it's so much more interesting to me for things to just completely be different every time. I mean, if you're gonna do something the same each time, why do it a second time? Our, you know, seventh take from our first take is completely different. Man, it's so awesome to be able to have a location for a week, go home, watch the dailies and go, man, we need to pick up here or that needs to be better there. And we can just jump back into the location and do it totally differently. But you know, things are just constantly evolving.
That was something on Newness that happened a few times. Scene 51, we shot, I think, three times.
Four times.
With that film as well, there's kind of an ambiguity to the ending, I would say, about where these people are with their relationship and what will come. So what you were missing in the original version of what we shot and how you altered that when we reshot it.
Was interesting. I think it was all on me. I think you and Lai were brilliant.
I thought we were great, and you just really.
You guys were. The problem with the scene the first time we did it, I think, was it kind of went from 0 to 100. It's such an emotional scene. This emotional realization that these two people are going to have to let go in order to be okay, and that things are going to be boring, and that things are going to be rough, and you're going to disappoint each other, and that's what love is, and that it's okay, that it's messy in that sense, and that it's not perfect, and you can spend your entire life trying to find something to complete you and never find it, because that's not the point. The point is to give yourself to somebody and try. So I feel like it went from 0 to 100 in this really emotional ball of fire, and what was missing from the scene when we reshot it the next day, and the set was like torn down, like half of it was torn down. And we just had that window and we were able to just come back and do those close-ups. And basically what we did is find that build, that moment when they realized that, and then they're allowed to get to that emotional state. And that's what was missing, that little 15-second moment between the two of them where they understand in each other that that's what they have to do to actually love each other and to accept this and to accept what it is. But wow. It's just cool revisiting this. Sorry, it's getting a little bit clumped there, but
no, it's all good.
Yeah, I think it's. I think that's just where I was at in my life, and just trying to understand the truth. And that's all I'm trying to do is just put stuff out there that feels honest. And if it feels honest to me, maybe it'll feel honest to some other people. But God, it'd be interesting to look at the first time we shot it, and the second time we shot it. But I think it was really just that missing beat in the scene. That turn, that moment, that feeling of acceptance. And essentially, acceptance turned into freedom, because that's what it is, I think, for me and for those characters, is realizing that the freedom they thought they needed outside of each other, they can actually find in each other. And that's the gift of monogamy, and that's the gift of giving yourself to another person. Really proud of that pivot in that scene. And it's such a special ending. And that's what's so great about doing it this way is, you know, a lot of times as a filmmaker, you want to think that you always have the answer and you always know what you're doing, but it's okay to not have the answer. And it's okay to sometimes keep exploring and to keep trying different things.
So with that, like, because a lot of your stories are very autobiographical and true to your life, is it something whereby when you're living life and you're having a normal day and then you feel something or something happens in a relationship, does your brain spark and go, oh, I need to capture this or explore that in a film to understand it better, to try and capture it for other people, so to understand if people are experiencing the same. How does that work?
Most definitely, the relationship aspects of my life confuse the fuck out of me. So I'm constantly trying to understand them better. And mistakes I've made and things I've learned, I'm trying to work through those through the movies. And I also feel like my parents' relationship, I'm still trying to reconcile in their divorce and growing up in that. You know, if something doesn't feel like true to me or I don't have something to say, then I shouldn't be making movies. So, you know, there's always a theme that I'm playing with. There's always an emotion about relationships or where I'm at in my life, and certainly had a lot of different things happen to me and experiences and things I've learned. So I'm just trying to kind of be honest. Like, I always describe the movies as like diary entries in a way, as opposed to writing a journal entry. They're kind of just an emotional spewing of feelings, essentially. And that's what Newness was. We were all at such an interesting place in our life, I think, really. You, me, and Ben, and Laya, even, you know, just coming here and suddenly just shooting the movie. It was just kind of this perfect, like, moment for us to explore these characters. But, you know, like I said before, I feel like my work is really polarizing, and I kind of love that because it invokes a reaction. And apathy would probably be the worst reaction to a movie. People love my movies, people hate my movies, but whatever it is. I used to get really emotional about it before and read reviews, and I don't read anything anymore. But I think every time you put yourself out there and you put your name on something, it's a huge risk. But that's the exciting part now, is kind of letting go of that. But God, every movie feels like a risk. It feels like such an intrusion into your soul, putting yourself out there. It's like, anytime we finish a movie, I'm always like, I just want to keep it. I don't want anyone to see it. I don't want to put it out there. I just want it to be mine forever, because it's such an intrusion. It's too personal. For you, is it that way? Like, when you choose to do a role, or you pick up a movie, is it like, okay, where do I find myself in this? Or how do I get there with this? Like, how does that process work for you?
Yeah, it's personal in the sense of you're going to be spending a lot of time pretending to be that character or that person. So you have to find an understanding somehow of them, but also it's a different level, because there's something that I can't quite put my finger on, but there can be something that is well written on the page that just doesn't spark to me, or I feel like it's too similar to something else, or I just don't imagine when I imagine it in my, that's a lot of the time, it's just my imagination. When I see it in my, like, the movie screen that I have running in my mind, do I imagine myself there doing it well? And if I don't, then I shouldn't be doing it.
Because it's so interesting to me, because you don't watch dailies. We didn't, you know, you like, I would show you things here and there, but you're like, oh, okay, you know, whatever. But how do you feel like when you watch a final version of your work? Like, is that hard for you? I always imagine, like, some actors are different. Like Guy Pearce, for instance, wanted to watch every take in every daily, which I found really interesting. But for you, like, when you watch any of your movies, like, how do you feel about it, like, with an audience?
It depends. The overwhelming thing that I feel is, because I know it so well, I feel like the pace is really slow.
Really? Really? Just,
yeah. And I think that's just because I know something so well. So I'm expecting the next thing. I'm on to the next thing rather than just enjoying what's happening on the screen at the time. I'm kind of watching it and fast forward in my mind. But I think that's something that I should probably get better at, like being able to watch and, because it's weird, it doesn't always line up what's in your mind and what you're feeling doesn't always line up with what's necessarily being exuded. Watching things is weird. But how do you go about that when you get to the edit and you sit there, and do you bring family and friends in? Who do you refer to in terms of when you think you've got your cut, and then someone's like, oh, actually, I think this, I think that. How does that work?
It's actually the most excruciating part of the process. You know, we call it taking your medicine. Where you know you're going to get your ass handed to you. I have a group of people, filmmakers, friends that I really trust, that are really smart, that really understand story, that really understand how to help me shape a movie. And it's like, you just take your medicine. The first month after that first cut is just excruciating, because it doesn't work until it works. So it's just, you know, it's constant, especially with our movies, with all the improvisation, there's so many different ways to put it together. And there's so many different ways you can tweak a scene to have a different outcome or a different feeling for the audience. So it's a puzzle.
Do you look back on things with hindsight, a couple of years on, a few years on, however long, do you look back and go, oh, if you ever see them, do you go, oh, you know what, I'd trim that now, or I'd change that now? And
what's the worst? That's why I can't watch anything. I mean, I'll watch the movie at the premiere, you know, whether we're at Tribeca or Sundance or Venice or whatever we've premiered our movies at, well, all of those, the movies we've done together, I'll watch it there with those audiences, and then that's the last time I'll ever see it. That's it, because I can't do it. You're right. Like, 2 years later, you're in such a different place in your life and creatively, that you would do everything differently. You could never understand why and how you made those decisions now, because you're not that person anymore. The term "you abandon a movie, you never finish it" is so true. Like, at a certain point, you just have to let it go. But it's never done. It's never perfect. That's what I love about filmmaking, is it's completely about embracing the imperfections, the accidents, the mistakes. And those are what makes something alive and special. So it's, yeah, never watch it again. Do you? No.
There's too many films that I'm not in that are really great films that I want to see, you know. Like, I haven't got time to sit around repeating watching my film.
Fair enough.
Talk to me about music, because I know that plays a big part in, like, your prep, and it plays a big part in, for me, working with you as an actor, preparing, because you send playlists of all the songs that you're thinking you might use in the soundtrack and to create a mood and all that. So just tell me about how that comes about and how you meld that into the filmmaking.
Yeah, I mean, it was so fun to work with you in both movies and play songs for you before the scene. I sometimes hide a speaker under the bed and play a little, you know, 20 seconds of music right before action, and it would kind of set a tone and a mood. I mean, I love making playlists for movies and sharing them with the crew and the actors, because it's descriptive in a way that words can't be. It's descriptive in a way that pictures can't be. You can't really describe how a piece of music makes you feel or what it makes you think about. So to me, it's really interesting, and it's a great tool to be able to share a feeling without having to describe it.
Yeah, the music thing is, I think the first time I registered that was, I was doing a film maybe when I was 18. I felt silly. It was like a bit of an action film, and like there was a group of guys all like walking across the desert or something. And I remember being like, I feel ridiculous doing this. This is silly. And then one of the other actors was like, yeah, but imagine when they put the score over it and like played me like, I think he played like the soundtrack of maybe The Dark Knight or something. He was like, imagine this as we're walking across doing that, overplayed over the top. And then I was like, I listened to that for a little bit, and I was like, oh yeah, now I'm getting hyped. This is what it's all about.
Yeah, there you go, man. It changes everything. I mean, it's so, yeah, I mean, I try not to lean on it or use it or try to drive emotion, but man, it can make something so much more dynamic. But yeah, I prefer movies that have slow motion shots of you walking to dramatic music. I don't think we had enough of that in our movie. I feel like we should go back and add some of that.
That's the main complaint I've got. Tell me about, so you mentioned earlier that one of the things that you love doing the most is working with actors, particularly me, et cetera, et cetera.
True.
Tell me about actors
on the whole planet.
Tell me what it is about actors that you, how you like working with them, manipulating them, figuring out what the right note is, what you're watching, how you perceive if they're doing something that's honest or if it's something that seems contrived or if they're reaching for something that's not there. Tell me that, what you're looking for as a director and how then you then go about achieving what you need.
Gosh, that's so interesting. I love talking about this. God, where to start? I don't know. I mean, I find actors to be so special because they're so vulnerable and they're so, I mean, it's not about manipulation. It's more about the collaboration, but it's like, I feel like an extension of what I'm doing is essentially what you guys are doing. You're both kind of in this dance together and you're both trying to figure it out and understand it.
I remember one scene in Newness, the scene when my character and Pom's character meet up. I remember you were directing, but tell me how this feels for you, or what it's like experiencing it, because it was something that I could tell was very emotional for you. You were kind of behind it, or divider, whatever you want to call it. But I could tell that it was very emotional for you watching that scene. So tell me what it's like living through it and what you're going through watching it. Is it?
Yeah. Well, that scene, like, to me, was about this sort of fantasy of a conversation I had with an ex, and you know, and I'm sure for Ben as well, but it was like, I mean, just so personal, because when you start to personalize things and make them about what you're feeling, you can get to a much deeper emotion. And I feel like in that scene, that's such a special scene for me, because it was like provided like closure for me in a way. I remember just crying the whole time, and I was like, okay, let's do it again. Let's try this, try that. But I was just so emotional watching that, because I was able to live something out that I couldn't live out in real life.
It's interesting you say that, because I do find that a lot when I'm watching something that nothing to do with me, that I'm just watching a show and it strikes a chord, or I relate to something that maybe I haven't even fully experienced that. I've experienced it, but I haven't fully put it into my words in my brain or whatever it is. I haven't fully understood it. And then I see it played out from a different character or a different person on the screen. And suddenly it hits a lot harder because I'm like, oh, that's all those things that I relate to. And that's the emotion. And then suddenly I'm like an absolute mess because it's been like laid out in front of me in a way that I can watch it and understand it.
Completely. Well, dude, I mean, it's interesting what you brought up earlier about us living together when we made Newness. That's really, really fucking interesting and unconventional. Like, we were together the whole time we were making that movie and like constantly talking about what we were going to do and talking about the next day. And what a gift, what a cool experience.
Yeah. I mean, I think it worked particularly because it was such a fast shoot. It was 18 days on 18, 19.
Yeah.
So it was like, it was almost like that streamlined the process that, so that we knew what we were going to be doing and could break it down in the evening or in the morning and the drive to work, whatever it was. So that on set, I was perhaps already kind of at least understanding of where your head was at with things. So that we didn't have to then have those conversations on set and like make everybody hang around, wait. And suddenly whilst it's like, oh, these guys don't communicate. They have no idea what's going on.
Amazing. I mean, how cool is that? Yeah. What a gift. And it was just such a blast too. Like making something that's ultimately so like kind of sad of a movie. Like all my movies are sad. For me, it's like being able to hang out with you or Anton and constantly be making each other laugh and goofing around and having a good time.
Tell me about that documentary about Anton, because that was, I mean, it's an incredible film that you guys made, but it's like, it's beautiful. It's heartbreaking. I remember being in pieces after that. And I never met or knew Anton, but tell me about that and just making the documentary and yeah, just talk about that for a second.
Yeah, I mean, that was a really special project last year. You know, if people haven't seen it, you can watch it, I think, almost anywhere, but it's called La Ventosa, and it was directed
He was such an like amazing talent, and watching him grow up, I was like, I don't know, it was like his understanding of film, but also his passion for it, and his knowledge, and like just the creativity that was inside of him. I was like,
oh man,
I was blown away by it.
Dude, yeah, I mean, I feel like every day I think about him and his process and how relentless he was at like exploring things and how curious he was at all art forms and how wickedly perverted he was about it. Like there was no boundaries with him. Like he was just so curious about humanity and sexuality and everything and how it related to filmmaking and his obsession with filmmaking. And I learned so much from him that I feel like, yeah, I mean, as close as we were making like crazy, you know, I feel like, yeah, I mean, I feel like I just treat things so differently now with people that I meet or work with, where it's like, oh my God, if you have a special relationship with somebody, that's something that you want to put time into and you want to stay connected, even though you're so busy. And that's one of the big regrets in my life is not staying more connected with him as he was making movies and I was making movies. Like, I wish we had, you know, we hadn't talked in a little while before he passed, and it just kind of such a bummer. But man, making the movie and producing that movie with, you know, for Garrett Price, who directed it, who's an incredible filmmaker, was such a wonderful experience to be able to do that for his parents, which, you know, it's just so tragic. But at the same time, like sharing his gifts with the world, and it just inspired a lot of people. And still think people are discovering the movie now, but yeah, it was a really cool thing to be able to do that while we were making Endings Beginnings. We were kind of doing both movies at the same time. And yeah, I mean, it's just a story that needed to be out there. And fuck, I mean, there's, you know, God, in 27 years, he did more than most people do in a lifetime as an artist.
I found it very inspiring. I found it I walked out of the theater that night when it premiered, and I was like, I felt, you know, when you get that fire in your belly.
That meant a lot to me to see you feel that way, because Anton would have loved that. Anton would have loved that he inspired you, and that would have meant a lot to him, and that's what he was all about. So that was a cool moment.
What's something you'd like to make if there were no restrictions ever in terms of time, budget, anything? Is there anything you'd like to do? Would you ever like to do like a Boyhood exploration, like something set over a certain amount of years, or what would be something that you're like, oh, I haven't quite got to that spot yet that I'd be confident or completely satisfied going in to do that, but it's like a big endeavor or create a process that you'd be intrigued to try.
Eventually, I'd like to do a father-son story. My dad and I have a really unique relationship where we weren't really close until I was out of high school, and it's a really kind of unique story, and he's a really unique person. But yeah, just trying to do stuff that's like not relationship-y, like trying to work on some stuff right now that's not your straight-ahead kind of relationship thing. I don't know, something that's scary, something that's different. I mean, even the, you know, Equals to me was that, where it was just like, man, trying to do something like this is so out of my comfort zone that it was exciting to just try and do something different. I don't know. I mean, coming out of the pandemic, I think it's like a nice reset where you just can try to do something totally different. But man, I'm definitely excited to go back to work. That's for sure. How about you? Like, is there anything specifically, like, I know you really want to make a boxing movie eventually, right? Like, you love boxing. You love racing.
I love boxing.
You've done racing movies. So like, is there anything?
Boxing racing movie.
Yeah.
You know what? My agent's always laughing me because I've got that real like side of me that just wants to go and like shoot guns and race cars and like do actiony sort of spy movies and all those sorts of things. And then there's the side of me that wants to go and make little independent relationship movies and all those. So it's, and then
yeah, you really are two different people. That's for sure.
I go do comedic period pieces or whatever. So it's like it's very tricky because there's. I think that's the thing.
I think that's called versatile.
Yeah, I don't like to do one thing. I get quite bored, I think. And I want to, I don't know, as an actor, I'm like, oh, I want to keep throwing things at people that they're like, oh, that was that guy. That was different. I didn't expect that. And yeah, but be versatile, I guess, because that's what I think being an actor is all about.
That's what's so fun for me, being your friend over the years now and watching all the things you've done in between our projects, is how different everything is. Like, it does, like, you definitely don't do the same thing twice, that's for sure. Everything is always something different. I mean, you're in there, but...
I take some swings.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. I mean, I guess The Favorite and The Great, those characters could be considered cousins in a way, evil cousins.
Yeah.
But I remember seeing The Favorite and just, I was like, holy shit. I mean, that was just
such a departure
from anything you've ever done.
This is going much better. Let's talk about the stroking of the shaft was
that's the best. I remember texting you after I saw the film, and you were like, "I added that myself." And I thought,
that was not scripted.
No, but that literally, I had to rewind that moment in the screener three times to watch it because I was laughing so fucking hard. I mean, that just absolutely destroyed me.
What about releasing a film during the pandemic? I don't know how you felt about it, but I felt kind of weird with The Great coming out. That was a TV show, so it's different because it was always planned to go to be streamed, but on Hulu, available now. But it was one of those things where it was like, it still felt weird to just be sat at home and like, oh, it's out, and that was it, and never do any press outside of my house and just talk to people through this and not have a screening or anything like that where you kind of hand it over officially. So what was that like for you?
Same, man. I mean, it was very strange, but in a way, I think it was kind of a blessing. Just kind of, you know, seeing how people reacted to the movie and how much it meant to some people meant a lot to us. And I think, honestly, more people probably saw it. It was cool because it felt like people were more interested in watching movies at home than ever before. And it kind of came at the right time and was kind of something that was different than anything that came out around it. And you know, I don't know. I mean, it kind of felt great to have to move people and to give them something emotional and different when they wanted to be moved or wanted to watch it. And like, all my films are polarizing. People fucking hate my movies. People fucking love my movies. But it just, more than ever, it's like, this is great. Let's get it out there and give it to the people that really want this and love it. So I don't know. It was weird. But, you know, like all the films, it was a really personal film and I'm super proud of it. And really proud of Shay in the film and think that it's something she's never done before and just really dynamic in it. And I think people really responded to her performance in the film. So I don't know. It was really weird, but it was oddly kind of cool to do it this way.
How did you feel?
I mean, but for you, it's the same thing too. It's like that wasn't going to play in theaters anyways. I mean, the only difference is you don't have to sit in a conference room for 2 days straight. You can just do everything from home, right? I mean,
it was nice in the sense of like when I was doing press, it was this. I could like literally come in my pajamas pretty much, sit there, chat to a few people, and then I can run upstairs and carry on with my life outside of it.
Speaking of which, like, what's the etiquette? Are you wearing pants right now for all your fans out
there? I'm not wearing any pants.
Okay, good to know. Good to know. Neither am I. I'm in boxers as well. So I think Nikki is an incredible moderator, and I'm so proud of her. And I love you, buddy. And I'm so grateful that you did.
It's
fun to talk about things we've done and process and stuff. And I'm so excited to see you continue to grow and learn and make movies and be an artist. So fun.
Hey, thank you, man. Likewise, I'm very happy to get to pick your brains for a little bit and understand what's going on so I can do better next time we make something.
Yeah, I can't wait, buddy. This is so, so fun and different and cool.